have good news for everyone today. The good news is that upon awakening from sleep today, I had this basic understanding. I woke up with this understanding of the truth, and I just said, wow, okay. I got up and I decided, let's not struggle with this. Now, the personality comes in with all its clouds and everything, but I said, okay, you know, I'm not going to struggle. I have a basic understanding that was there as I woke up in the morning. So this is very, very good news. I was quite, you know, a little bit surprised. I said, hey, I like that. That's wonderful. I said, I'm not going to try to explain it. I'm not going to try to struggle with it. I said, okay, I know I'm okay with it. There's no question I'm okay with it. Now, the great thing about the real heavyweight teachers is they abide in the truth in an unshakable manner. Nothing can disturb them or shake them at all. Whereas us, for example, we can get shaky about it. We can get nervous. We can say, oh, I can't quite, you know. We can be disturbed. They cannot be pulled out of truth, abiding in the truth. They cannot be pulled out of it. This is what makes them so valuable to us right now. Now, I'm not following the news, but as I said, when you go around your day, you meet people who make comments about, and then you hear a little bit of it that way, which is fine. That's all you really need. Somebody said, wow, you know, there's a lot of this going on. Or, oh, did you know the situation over there? I say, no, what's going on there? And they tell me a little bit, and I say, oh, okay. But I'm not paying any attention to the media and the news and all this stuff at all. So I'm able to focus in on truth very, very well. But apparently there's, lots going on. As I said, the turmoil is becoming intense, and it's just the beginning. It'll get worse and worse and worse. So we need, and the blame game is going to get extreme in this world. This is the problem. And it's going to be twice as bad as the 60s, for instance. So knowing what the 60s were like, and it's going to get at least twice as bad. Or at least, which is really unfathomable. I mean, the blame game, there's extreme blame games going on then. The blame game is going to become just completely unmanageable early in the world. And this is what you have to avoid, is the blame game. So how are we going to avoid it? Does anyone know how? Well, I've been following this narrative of how we're going to sidestep the blame game for my whole life. I've been saying there's going to be a way to do it. There is going to be a way to do it. I'm convinced of this. Certainly, if there was those here who were unshakable in realizing that they're not playing the blame game at all, they're absolutely not playing the blame game, this would be extremely helpful refuge to associate with them in whatever way we can. And this would calm us down and keep us from getting sucked into the blame game. So this is what we hope for. And this is what I believe in some way will happen. Because we think, maybe I can, you know, I can go into abidance. Yes, I can. But I also get pulled out of it because there's all this, there's both a blame game and a triumph game going on. Like we need to overcome something, an overcoming game, a game of overcoming. Now, let's keep in mind that the central teaching of Jesus is that it's, everyone has perfect standing with God, and it's impossible to change that. Everyone has this perfect inclusivity. We're all one family, perfect inclusivity, and no way that we can ever have that diminished in any way whatsoever. And I've experienced this, vision of oneness. I experienced it, actually. I didn't see it mentally or intellectually. I actually experienced it as an experience, an overall experience. I was aware that this is true. This is absolutely true. So this is all that Jesus is telling us, really, is this game of blame and judgment. It's all completely silly and a complete waste of time. We cannot diminish our status, our standing in reality at all. It's impossible. That's a very simple message, isn't it? And that's pretty much it. It's impossible to diminish our standing in reality. So why are we desperately trying to do so? You know, it's much ado about nothing. It has no effect whatsoever on our standing with God. God created us absolute perfection, extended us as God extended itself as us. We're absolutely perfect. God is completely unaware, you know, of anything. All our protests to the contrary, God doesn't pay any attention to whatsoever. He says, I know that I created you perfect. You remain perfect because you're an idea within my mind, and I hold you there perfectly. So you continue to be perfect, and you always will be. And perfect freedom, perfect inclusivity. And there's nothing, the idea of changing, that's impossible. You're an idea within my mind. I created you as an idea within my mind. So just to have someone here who witnesses to this is an extreme antidote to the blame game, which is going to get out of hand, to say the least. And, you know, I don't worry too much about specifics. I just have been told by the Holy Spirit that for sure it's going to get, you know, totally out of hand. And, you know, you could see some of the chess pieces that are being moved around. But it's not really worth trying to, you know, follow any of that, because no matter how the blame game is played, it's all completely much ado about it. It's much ado about nothing. Absolutely nothing is happening in terms of blame and judgment. God doesn't judge what God created, an idea in the mind of God. God knows that it's perfect. God doesn't need to judge. God knows that it's all perfect. Everything that God created is absolutely perfect. And we keep thinking that we can sin against God, meaning change what we are, change God, change what we are. It's not possible. So Jesus is not someone who comes back in wrathful judgment. Not at all. He comes back in peaceful friendship, saying, you know, he sees everyone as an aspect of the one family, in perfect standing with God. This is what Jesus knows. He knows this, and it's unshakable. This knowing is unshakable. Now, in my case, I've had glimpses of it, and I'm simpatico with the explanation. And I agree that this must be so, but, you know, I don't have this unshakable vision of it, that without any worry that the vision could waver on it or something. You know, I don't have that. It'd be nice if I did, but I know Jesus does, and I know these other, like Rama Maharshi, Longchenpa, these kind of teachers, they do have that vision. They do have the vision, this vision, unshakable vision. And this would be vastly helpful for us. Okay. For those who are aware of this. And we don't have to explain. I mean, what is there to explain? It's very clear. We're an idea in the mind of God. God extended itself as us. And we are perfect as God created us. And there's no way to change that. There's no way to change it. So what else is there to say? You know, well, why are we trying to change it? Well, we've gone over that. We're trying to be greater than God. We're trying to show that we can change what we are, but we can't. So there's no point in getting into this blame game and judgment game. Judge not, lest ye be judged. As soon as you start judging, then you believe that you can be judged. And you cannot be judged. Nobody can be judged. We're all in perfect standing, and we can never lose it. It doesn't matter what anybody does or doesn't do. They're all trying to lose their status, you know, really. This world's all about trying to lose status. not gain it. It's a vast exercise in trying to lose status. We're trying to pretend we don't have perfect status. We're all slumming. You know, we've had this make-believe pretending, pretense slumming. We're pretending that, you know, we're bodies in a world, and you know that we've lost all this perfect standing. You know, but this is not true. It's pretending. It's like trying to put on a sad face when you're really perfectly happy. And then, so it's that simple. There are those who have realized this and have been in the world, and they've been very helpful for the world. And when people are around them, the whole blame game just seems to evaporate. You know, it's gone. Now, obviously, if you're really into the blame game, when you're around, if you're around someone like that and the blame game evaporated, you would say, oh, whoa, I'm losing my status, you know. So, but keep in mind that this whole world is an attempt to lose status. So what you're doing is you're losing the pretense of losing status, is what's really going on. Losing the pretense of losing status. What's wrong with that? Nothing's wrong with that. And it's so simple that it's hard to explain, because it's not anything other than we can't lose our status. It's impossible. That's all there is to say. So, but the ego just overlooks that. It says, well, okay, well, let's set that aside for a minute. And then, okay, now without that, you know, then explain to me, you know. And of course, if you set the truth aside, how can you explain anything? How is anything explicable? If you set that, so the ego said, let's just set truth aside for a moment. Just for a moment. But if you set truth aside for a moment, where are you then? You're in an inexplicable situation, right? Completely inexplicable, because you can't set truth aside. You're in a hypothetical scenario. You're in a pretense. So what the ego says, let's just pretend for a moment that truth isn't true. Well, is that a wise thing to do? So the great teachers, they don't set truth aside for a moment and say, well, let's set it aside and see if truth wasn't true, what would we be like? They don't do that. They say, no, truth is true. Truth is always true. There's no moment where truth is not true. It's impossible to set it aside. And so everything is great. Everything is perfect. There's only perfection. There's nothing other than perfection. So it was really great to wake up this morning from sleeping and feel this way and see it, and means that somehow it's been, you know, it's seeped down within me to the point where now even when I'm sleeping, I'm aware of this. Sleep, and now waking sleep, both in sleep and waking sleep, I'm aware of this. That's a big positive. Well, that's very good news. It's very good news. It shows that we can make progress towards this, you know, complete simplicity. And of course, we again say, well, it doesn't seem simple. Well, if we set aside truth, what seems simple? Utter confusion. Because then you say, well, I can lose my status. Is something to be gained and lost. It's up for grabs. And then, of course, we're frantically trying to, you know, gain status here. And then everyone assumes that the great teachers have somehow found a way to gain status. There's some secret way to gain status. No, there's no secret way to gain status. There's no way to gain status. It's simply accept the truth that you can't lose it. So there's no way to attain enlightenment or status with God. No way to attain it, because there's no way to lose it. We already have perfect status. How can there be anything to attain then? It's utterly ludicrous. We don't need to attain what we already are. That's just absolutely silly. So we're trying to lose status here. Now, of course, as long as we think that, you know, we have a body and a world, it's easy to believe that you've lost status. That's the extraordinary capacity of the great teachers, is they're able to be here in the world with moving a body around and stuff, and yet never feel at all that they've ever lost the slightest bit of status. Now, this is extraordinary. But there are some who've done that. But it's very extraordinary. And I'm saying they very well may be coming back right now to help us out, to help the ones out who are ready to accept it, but need, you know, confirmation, reassurance, you know, a boost with it, with this. Especially at this time where the ego is making extraordinary, desperate efforts to suck us all into the blame game. Who has what? You know, status game. Which is really loss of status game. You look at some of these teachers and they're not trying to gain any status at all. Because they know it's impossible to lose perfect status. They have perfect status, as does everyone else. So they're not concerned with all the status games, which is the world. It's much ado about nothing, nothing whatsoever. So they may not know about the news or not pay any attention to it or care what's going on at all. On the other hand, they may be perfectly aware just to, for the standpoint of helping people realize you don't need to identify with this. If they need to know, they can know. But there's no really need to know as far as, you know, who's where on the status game. There's no status game. Which is why it's a little misleading. The esotericism is a little misleading, actually. There's some good stuff they say, but the idea that we're going through this evolution of consciousness and gradually we gain higher and higher status and it just goes on and on, higher status. This is not what Jesus teaches at all. He does not teach esoteric teaching. He says that we all inherently were created with absolute perfect status. And this, everything that we seem to be experiencing, evolution of consciousness and everything, is just the game of trying to lose status, actually, and cover it up by saying, well, we can always gain it back, you know. No. How can you gain back what you never lost in the first place? Is that really a gaining back or a setting down of the idea that we could have ever lost it in the first place? And if we couldn't lose it in the first place, that means everyone has equal status already. So esoteric explanations, you know, are one way of looking at it. They may be saying, well, you gain it back bit by bit by bit by bit. But they don't really say that. And by presenting it the way they present, it opens the door for a great misinterpretation, actually. Because, you know, it's just a matter of giving up pretense. Really, that's all it is. You don't have to do anything. What do we have to do to give up what doesn't exist? Other than the continuity fear. So, I prefer to look at it in the way that I'm presenting it, rather than the esoteric way. And so far, it seems to have worked. Seems to have worked. And, you know, we'll have to see going forward. Now, 23rd of September, Pope and President, the two leaders of neo-humanism, New World Order, the biggest players on the stage by far, biggest players on the stage, at least in the public eye, are going to roll out the red carpet for one another, so to speak. And this marks, you might say, if the official birth of the new world, the conception of the new world order. They'll look back on this event as being the seminal event of the conception of the new world order, and they'll be able to, you know, historically they'll be able to look at this sort of thing. That they want some historical foundation behind it, so it gives seems, you know, this whole status thing. We need to gain status, and we need to do what God wants us to do. I mean, how can we, you know, get right with God? How do we get right with God? You know, this is the question. You know, I'm a sinner. How do I get right with God? I'm so worried. No, you can't get wrong with God. And so when we say that we're worried about not able to get right with God, we're really talking about God as the continuity fear. And we're afraid that we need, you know, how do we get right with the continuity fear? Oh, we got to just affirm that we're really humans. And that's how we get on the good side of the continuity fear. So neo-humanism is just simply a desperate attempt to get everybody in the world to agree that they're human. You know, which is what Google is trying to do. They're a big part of it. This is you know, utter delusion. It's the Antichrist, if you want to talk about it in religious terms, but it's total self-delusion, and it's just a dance of continuity fear is all it is. There's nothing to blame. Why blame anyone? They have perfect standing with God. But pragmatically, we're simply just aware we don't have hatred for anyone. Don't have hatred. I don't feel hatred for anyone. Hopefully that comes through the videos. But I'm aware, you know, hate the sin, love the sinner, so to speak. I mean, the idea of trying to get everyone on the wrong page, as if we're all on the wrong page, that somehow makes the page right. This is just a folly, and it's just delay. It's just severe delay. It causes a lot of suffering. And, of course, we're all complicit in it, unless we decide not to be. So we just have to be aware that, hey, I don't want to go down that road. You know, no thank you. No thank you. Been there, done that. The goal, get everybody to believe that we are simply human. Forget about the perfect status with God. That's just a myth, you know, they say. It's a ridiculous myth. It interferes with being fully human. We need to fully develop the human potential. The human potential movement. I've got to fully develop the human potential. And this is, you know, neo-humanism, the Aquarian conspiracy. Fully develop human potential. I can tell you for sure this has nothing to do with the teachings of Jesus or the other great teachers. Nothing to do with it whatsoever. Jesus is not going to come back as some leader of the Aquarian age. Okay? That's not going to happen. There's no such thing from Jesus' standpoint. It's Jesus comes back. Look, every single one of you, I see you with as perfect standing with God, with reality. You haven't done anything to change that, and never can. This is how I see you. No judgment at all. There's no need for judgment. He doesn't look through the eyes of judgment at all. You're already perfect. What Aquarian age? I don't need the Aquarian age. There's a mockery of reality, really. It's just mocking reality. These ages that we go through, we're just mocking reality. What good does that do? But that doesn't change our standing with God, not in the slightest bit. So this viewpoint is quite rare here in the world. There's no question about it. I've worked my whole life to get to this viewpoint. And it's very difficult for us. It just seems to keep slipping away. But I woke up this morning and it was just there. It was just there. And I said, oh, yeah, I'm very simpatico. Very much on the same page with that. But, of course, the personality isn't. So I go around, I say, I don't act that way, really. Because everybody expects you not to act that way. You see, this world is overwhelmingly humanistic, and the religions are also, you know, very judgmental. You know, and thinking that God is a judgmental God, you know, this is not true at all. And so you have to act, you know, when in Rome, kind of act like a Roman. So personality, you know, keeps reacting like people. I think people want me to react and expect me to react. The expectations here are overwhelming. So you get someone like Jesus, and it's very difficult just in this, especially in this world, modern world right now, to not react that way at all to anything. Yeah, but Jesus, didn't you know? Don't you know that terrible things happened since you've been here last? You know, oh my gosh. Certainly there must be an exception. I mean, there's got to be an exception. God must make an exception to truth. And this is our belief that you know, we're trying to figure out, well, we know there must be an exception somewhere, so that's, well, you know, where is it? But no, there isn't any. It's a useless search. So call off that useless search. So a couple more days till the 17th. Now, the 17th, if you go forward 40 weeks from the 17th, what is that? How many? It's about 280 days or something like that, which is the period of gestation. From the 17th, you get to June 22nd, 216. So I believe that the, you know, the 17th is and that's right in between, pretty much in between, isn't it, the 11th, September 11th, and the 23rd. So I said that the between the 11th and the 23rd is the conception period of the New World Order. So, you know, if you go right in the middle, you could say, okay, well, we'll say in the middle of that is you say that's the, you might say that's the actual conception date. If you go forward 280 days, you hit exactly June, brings you right to June 22nd, which is the day that the Holy Spirit told me we have to be ready by that day. We have to be truly confirmed in truth, non-judgmental truth, no blame, and accept everyone's perfect standing in reality. At least have that basic confirmation. Okay, this is, you might call it confirmation. So I got a confirmation this morning as I woke up. I feel like I've been confirmed, because I didn't have to think about it. It was just there. So it's part of me now. I didn't know. It doesn't require me thinking. It somehow has sunk in to me. So the 17th is like just basically, today's the 15th, we're one day away from the 17th. So I feel I got this confirmation just in time. And then the official, you know, 23rd is to say to the world, yes, there has been a conception. We're just, you know, marking the conception has already happened. It's the official world consciousness event of the Pope and the President. There'll be more attention on that than almost any event in history, actually. It's a huge, huge global event. And, you know, they'll probably, you know, they will. I mean, they'll come out and say, we have a fundamental agreement, you know, and all these issues are fundamentally, oh, they always say, well, there's a few things we may not agree on, but they probably won't even say that. They'll say, yeah, we've come to this agreement between the two of us, and we've agreed that we're going to go forward and work together going forward. And that's it. This is the New World Order, you know, really. You get the leader of the, quote, free world. At least they tell us that we're free. They've done a great job propagandizing that. And the leader of 1.2 billion Catholics. Agreeing, you know, that, okay, we agree that we're going to work together here. And we found we have a wonderful working relationship. We have the same goals. We have the same basic goals. And so we're all going to work on this together now. We've decided it's going to be a global effort. And there you go. Off and running. And this is what, you know, the neo-humanists have been waiting for, which is just, again, the dance of continuity fear, saying, all right, at last we can work on being fully human. You know, try to gain some status within humanness. Within bodiness, within embodiedness, with, you know, entombed in a worldness, you know, and it's just ridiculous from the standpoint of truth. You know, it's just absurd, but it's very difficult to act as if this whole mindset of the world is completely absurd, because they'll all say that you're crazy. This is what they will do, you know. Absolutely, if you really come out as the truth and the way, and so there's no judgment from God, everyone has perfect status, nothing is happening here as far as your status goes, absolutely nothing is happening, it never will, you know, they're going to say you're just completely cuckoo. And so it takes someone who's extraordinary to abide in this truth here. Now, it's going to be quite amazing to see it in modern times, because, you know, most of these teachers were abiding in it, you know, in the some point in historical past. And right now, it's amped up to a large extent. It's kind of like you get someone like a lounge, someone's playing cool jazz, a band's playing cool jazz in the lounge, and people are chatting, you know, and talking, there's some cool jazz in the background. You say, oh, we can still talk and chat and stuff. And then you get like some, you know, heavy metal thrash band, you know, all, with banks of amp of Marshalls, and they're on, you know, on 12, and they just like are crushing, so you're like a wall of sound, and like, you can't even hear yourself think. You lose your hearing, and you know, you talk, you can't communicate at all. You talk to people and they can't even, what are you saying? I can't hear anything. And he's like, I can't hear anything. So this is like the modern world. We can't hear anything. So it's a lot more intense now. Globally intense. So to abide in that, abide in truth, with all this going on, is quite a feat. And it's not like a back to nature thing, or it's not anything like that. Because it's like, oh, it has to do with everything here. And from our standpoint, certainly with all the people here, of the fact that they, you know, all of this is just a cartoon like pretense of trying to lose status. And it doesn't work. There's no validity to it. There's no truth to it. There's no effectiveness to it. There's no, it's not causative in any way. If such a teacher showed up, I would certainly go see them, you know, and just sit there and, you know, get used to it. But it's the message that I'm waiting for and waiting to hear is that clarion call of everyone already has perfect status. They never lost it. Perfect standing. Perfect inclusivity. Perfect standing. You know, we think in the great one family, there's just this weight one family. We think that a spiritual family that, you know, I mean, I've lost status. I have to regain it. How do I regain it? You know, I got to do all the spiritual practice. I got to do a lot of good works. I got to show I'm a good person to everybody. I lost. This is not true. This is absolutely not true. Nobody has lost any status whatsoever. And this is what I saw in the Vision of Oneness. Nobody's lost any status. Impossible. Nobody has to do good works. I mean, in order to do good works, you got to come into this world, don't you? In order to suffer, I need to suffer for my sins. I've lost status, you know, and so I need to pay punishment for losing status, and that will help me regain my status. You have to come into this world. You have to believe you're a body for all this nonsense. No one has lost any status. In fact, there is no way to do so. There's no way to do so. Everyone is perfectly free. Everyone has the status of absolute freedom. You can't mess that status up. It's not possible. And yet in this world, it gives the overwhelming effect as if it is possible. So it's quite extraordinary for those who are able to abide here and walk about with all the people in the world, etc., and you know, never lose that truth at all. And it seems to be, it's enough for us to right now, to glimpse it, and to keep working on it. And we're getting close to it. You know, I'm close to it, but I feel like, okay, you know, just have to keep working at it. It's very difficult to not be judgmental in the world because people are acting like idiots, right? But keep in mind, they're acting like idiots in an attempt for you to judge them as idiots. See, that's their goal. They're trying to change their status. They're trying to say that they have some status that can be changed instead of absolute perfection. Absolute perfection is not a status. It's the truth. So because all these various vague things can happen to the body, take place with the body, seem to, we think that you know, different statuses can be attained. You know, someone's crippled, someone's young, someone's old, all these things. And, you know, it's very difficult to realize this. It's just a shadow play. And it's all make-believe. It's all pretense, make-believe. Nobody's old, nobody's young, nobody's old, nobody's a body, nobody's sick, nobody's well, nobody's infirm, nobody's, you know, none of these categories. Everyone's perfect. Perfect is not a category. It's the unassailable truth of right now. So we say, well, let's set aside right now for a moment. Then what, we're in time, in the belief in time. And then everything seems infinitely complex, infinitely variable, right? And then we immediately feel that we're in danger of losing some sort of status. And we have to, oh my gosh, you know, how can I regain my status? I feel it's vulnerable. You know, how do I defend it? How do I protect it? Well, of course, if we set aside truth for a moment, or at least, you know, believe we can, we're going to feel that way. We feel like, hey, what happened to my perfection? I see it now as vulnerable. It's not vulnerable. We just tried to set it aside. So you really cannot engage with the ego, because the ego's whole premise is that, well, you know, we can set truth aside for a moment, for just a moment, just as a, was it matter if we set aside for a moment? That's the same as setting aside forever. Because if you set aside for a moment, where is there your perfection of reality? Then you're saying it doesn't exist. The whole thing about reality is it's always real. There's no gap. As soon as we say that there's a gap in it, well, just a little gap, you know, for a moment. As soon as we believe there's a little gap, even for a moment, we believe we set it aside forever. Because in our mindset, that reality doesn't exist anymore, because there's a gap, there's a flaw, there's a gap. So Jesus knows there is no gap, it doesn't exist. Hypothetical, just a hypothetical scenario that we've been entertaining. But people will think we're crazy. Those who are playing the status game, they say, you're crazy. You're not helping me with my status. What do you mean I'm perfect? I'm not perfect. I'm sick. I'm not saying anyone's perfect. I'm saying everyone is. There's a difference. Everyone. There's no such thing as imperfection. Well, look, I'm getting old. I'm getting sick. Well, that's pretense. That's pretending. That's not reality. We're free to pretend anything we want. But, you know, it's silly. Doesn't change the facts at all. But they get together. Well, they agreed that they hurt me, and I agree that I was hurt by them. You know, this is all agreements of pretense. Oh yeah, well, they got died. Someone killed them, and well, they're saying, well, I agreed to be killed by them, and they agreed to kill the body, my body, and then we both agree that this will prove that that we are vulnerable and not perfect, and that status can be won and lost, and you know, this is all pretense. So the 17th is coming up in just about a day now. So we're right on track, and you know, like I saw with those deer, boom, 1, 2, 3, just popping out of nowhere. You don't see them coming. Of course, they told us that they're coming, let it know, but still, you know, as far as like the suddenness is suddenly, you know, the deer is just like, boom, right there. You know, quickly, they emerged very quickly. They didn't like hesitantly poke their head out and look around. No, the deer just came bursting out of the thicket, you know, like that. Burst upon the scene. So one way or another, we'll find out about it. Whatever happens, you know, somehow we will find out about it. We have our antenna up for this. And most people, they go to teachers hoping that the teacher will judge on their side, on their status. Oh yeah, you're right, and those other people are wrong. Yeah, they're terrible people. They're doing these terrible things, but you're doing the good thing. You're a good person. Have you done good works? Have you done the good works? Great. Have you been, you know, praying to increase your status? Oh, wonderful. You know, those other people. Oh yeah, they're really out of it. You know, but this is not a real teacher. You know, anything like this is not a true teacher. Not a teacher of truth at all. Now, the practices are not to increase our status, but to just evaporate the continuity fear to realizing that everyone has perfect status. That's all. It's not to increase our status. It's to evaporate the continuity fear so we can have the vision of oneness where we see everyone has perfect status. That's what I saw in the vision of oneness. It wasn't my status. It was everybody's status. I saw everyone's status. And seeing that this is true for everyone, it's true for me too. But it wasn't like me being enlightened or my status being raised up or anything like that. And no, it's just it's everyone has the same status, which is perfect. Absolute inclusivity, absolute freedom. No matter, even though most people were just standing there inert, most aspects of spirit, I saw them as just kind of like standing still, you know, because they're enmeshed in this dream of trying to lose their status. But I said, no, I can see you haven't lost any status at all. Not at all, not in the slightest bit. But you see, people want to judge others so to make themselves seem righteous. Now, it is true that there are many who do things trying to lose their status that we deplore because we don't want to be tempted into that way, which is fine. That's completely understandable. We see activities and stuff that, you know, the humanists are trying to, yeah, we're just human. Well, they're desperately trying to, you know, lose their status and make their loss of status permanent. You know, the effort to make it permanent. That's deplorable. Silly, whimsical, and deplorable, meaning we don't want to be engaged in that. That's the last thing we want to do, is play the status, get involved in the status game. Because it's just needless delay, absolutely needless delay, with a ton of suffering in it. So it's not like we're saying, oh, sure, doing that that's the right way to spend your time. We don't say that. We certainly admonish everybody. But the admonishment is not status judgment related at all. It's a non-judgmental admonishment. It's a difference. So this, and people think, oh, you're judging me. No, I'm admonishing you that this is a waste, complete waste of your time trying to lose status in this way. You're desperately trying to lose status, and you cannot. It's an absolute waste of your time, and I'm not going to engage in that myself at all, because I realize that, you know, this has no benefit to it. You know, it leads you astray. So all these ways that lead us astray, we admonish them. We don't like that. We don't want to be led astray. So this is the confusion we have. We think that some of these people who are on the path, you know, that they're judgmental. No, they're saying, I want to be certain. Yeah, I don't want to be led astray by that. I don't want to be led astray by that. No, no, thank you. Thanks, but no thanks. I don't want to believe I can lose status, that anyone can lose status. I refuse to acknowledge that you can lose status. And they're saying, oh, come on, come on, come on. You see that I definitely have lost status? Are you kidding me? Look at me. I'm all, you know, got death tattoos all over me. You know, I'm worshiping the devil. I'm doing this. You gotta judge me, you know. No, I'm not going to judge you at all. I know you have perfect status. They don't want that, you see. They hate that because they think that they have lost status. And they're terrified because of the continuity fear. They're terrified to stop pretending is what it is. And so if you just say, no, you haven't lost any status at all, that means, oh my gosh, you know, I have to stop pretending. This is really pretending? I can't stop pretending. I'll have no identity, no function then. So this is the trouble. The continuity fear is the only trouble there is in the world, actually. But the people here in the world are going to become so demanding that we acknowledge that they've lost status, that it could be quite troublesome here for us. Someone tipped me off to some things today. Just, you know, I don't ask for these things. People just come up and